with us this morning for prayer? What a wonderful time to serve God. God is awesome God. Lord, we thank you for this day. God, this time we come in to worship you. Time we cast all of our cares upon you this morning, God, because you care for us. We ask you now, God, to touch us, be with us. We ask you, Lord, to touch every need in this building this morning. God, that we lay it on the altar, God, and we confess it to you. We ask, God, that you would take care of every need, no matter what bad or how small or how big they are, God, we put them in your hands. And God, we claim them right now in your name. Amen. Turn around, shake somebody's hand, hug their neck, and tell them how glad you are to see them. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Good to have all our visitors. Praise the Lord. Good to have everybody out with us this morning. We're serving an awesome God. Praise the Lord. And God looks so good, I tell you. God is so good to us, isn't he? How wonderful. I'm glad to have my niece's daughter, Brianna, here with us, and her friend. And always good to have family members come in. And we're so glad to have everybody. Bri, I'm glad to have you. I'm just glad to have everybody. Turn around to your neighbors. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. Praise the Lord. I usually give you my five, but instead of doing that this morning, I'm going to give you a praise report. Brother Bigham been fighting cancer. For what, 4 years? 3 years? He's had chemo, and today he's cancer free. He went in this week and had that port taken out. He'd been carrying around for years. This doctor put it in there just in case the cancer came back. But they finally pulled that cord out, and today he's cord free. Isn't that an awesome God that we serve, isn't it? Amen. Praise the Lord. And we won't know how that feels, and you're very blessed if you don't, to carry that around and have that down in you for all these years. And we know God's still on the throne. Amen. God still answers prayer. Friend of ours that she lost her husband here a while back. She'd been by herself. She'd been going through a battle. And her well quit working. She lost half her money when her husband died because he was in the service. And Social Security, she lost half of her income. And then the well quit. And she called him out and said it'd be about $6,000 to fix it. But there was a kid that they knew. Him and his dad worked in the well, doing well work and well business. And he came out here and told Connie. He said, you know what? She said, how much is it going to cost? He said, we could do it for $3,000 to $4,000. She doesn't have no quarrels. She asked God, God help. And the preacher, he said, just a minute. John, he went home, he was gone for a while, come back. And he had some parts. And he fixed that for $400. That may not seem like a very big blessing or a praise report to you, but you're not there. We're not there. If you're in their shoes, ask to jump up, shout, hallelujah. Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
It go to tell you that God's still God. They go to tell you that God still takes care of your small needs as well as your big needs. That's the God that we're serving today. That's the God that we're serving today. And beside that, he fixed. She had hard water. And he put a softener on there. He put a filter on there. Things that would cost about a total of $10,000. She got for a little of nothing.
She had to buy a from the Lord.
And I'm happy because when I go up there, I don't have to take a shower in hard water. It's bad enough to get beat anywhere else, but get beat with hard water is really bad. I'm going to be gone. Me and Sis are going to be gone this week sometime. We won't be here Sunday, but we want you to be here. We had an emergency that came up down in California, so we'd be gone for a few days. Brother Gary will be preaching Sunday morning for me. Brother John will be preaching Sunday night. Brother John will be watching over things while I'm gone, and he has the key. And so we got other ministry around here also to fill in the gap. It's amazing because I got five ministers to take my spot. So I do a five-man job. So there you go. What can I say? But anyhow, they'll be filled in. Pray for us. But remember also Valentine. We got our Valentine dinner coming up. Our banquet. So we're excited about that. Saturday, 5 o'clock. So God's so good to us. Anyhow, I want to tell you that. But make sure you're faithful to God's house because I'm gone. And somebody said, well, Pastor, you're going to look for another church. No. I'm the overseer of this church.
Yes.
I'm the one who started this church. Amen. I'm not looking for no other church to start.
Amen.
I think sometimes there's a problem with me when I started this one. What was I thinking? Because everything falls on my shoulders. But yeah, I'm the overseer. Me and my wife started this and this ministry here for one reason: to minister to hurting people, to mend broken hearts, broken lives, and broken people. That's why God told us to start this ministry here. So, denominational, we're here to just worship God. There's no political things involved in it. There's no politics. We don't come here to get something out of church. We come here to put something in. Amen. And what that is praise for what God has done for us. Amen. When we come into this place, this is a place where we say, God, thank you for what you've done. It's not asking God for any more things than he's already done. Because he's done everything already for us. All we have to do is accept and praise him for what he did do for us. On Calvary, he died. He paid the price. He did it back for a beating that we could be healed. But just praise him for God, what God has already done in our life. That's what we're here for. Amen. To glorify him and lift him up.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
I want to give you some of my scriptures. Some of them I'm going to give them to you later. Some of them you just have to find them. The Bible said to us in James 4, 7, and 8 that we have to do something to God, for God to do something for us, we have to do something for him. First of all, he said you have to submit yourself, therefore, to God. You have to re-give yourself completely to God. Submit. A lot of people don't like to submit. A lot of people don't want to give up control. A lot of people like to hang on to things. But the Bible said we have to submit everything to Him.
Right.
Submit ourselves, our problem, our situation. Submit it all. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. And He said, then you've got to do something else. You've got to resist the devil. The devil's going to come to try to tempt you and try to get you down. He's going to try to destroy you. You have to, when you submitted everything to God, then you begin to resist the devil. Hey, devil, you ain't bothering me. I'm turning my back on you, Lord. And the Bible said he would flee from us. Not just walk, he would run from us. But we have to first submit ourselves. And if you ain't totally submitted to God, you're going to have problems telling the devil to take a hike. But we first got to be able to say, God, here I am. I submit everything to you. Then I have the power to resist the devil when he comes around. And when the devil comes around, I say, oh, speak to the hand. Nope, I'm resisting you. But stop saying that. And the Bible said he will turn and run. He will flee from you because he knows you are already submitted under the blood of Calvary. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. The devil has no power over you, only what you allow him to have. If you let the devil do it, you are a blame for it as much as he is. Because you have the power and the ability to resist him. But there's so many times in our life that we don't want to fully sell out to God. The Bible said you cannot serve two masters. And the Bible said if you love the world, the love of God is not in you. Somebody said, well, that's not contrary to the word of God because John 3:16, for God so loved the world. No. The terminology is different. He was talking about people he did his son for that he loved. Are you still with me?
Yeah.
But if we love the materialistic things of the world, the love of God is not in us.
Yeah.
How many people do you know in this world today say, I love my car? Get off from it. That's a bunch of metal. That's a piece of garbage. How can you love something materialistic? Or I love my house. Love is not words. Love is feelings. What are you got to do?
I don't mean that. Oh, no, that's good preaching.
People think I love this and I love that. And all it is just words. But what I really love and what I really submit to is Jesus Christ. Even God, when he made the world, he didn't say, I loved it. He said, it's good. He didn't say, I loved it.
No.
When he created, he looked and he said, that's good. And we said, that's great. But we have to be willing to say, God, here it is in your hands. Then we have to be willing to resist the devil to show him our bloodstained banner of the old rugged cross.
Amen.
I said, devil, you can't touch me. I'm under the bloodline. I'm under the blood of Calvary. You can't cross the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm here to tell you today, church, that God said he'd give us power over all the power of the world.
Yeah.
Let me take you to another verse. Luke 10:18. And he said unto them, Jesus did, I beheld Satan.
Yes.
As lightning falling to the earth. Here Jesus is saying, I was there when God kicked the devil out of heaven and he was like lightning that hit the earth. I was there when God took dominion over it. Listen to what I'm saying to you here now, church. Jesus is telling it, and Luke is writing it. And in verse 19, behold, I give you power. Next verse down, he seen Satan kicked out of heaven like lightning coming down to the earth. Behold, I give you, power to trod upon the serpent and the scorpion and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Or one scripture saying, set on you. I hate it when people sit on me. Because you're more than sitting. How many know that you want to do something and you got people sitting on you? Jesus tells us here, I seen Satan kicked out of heaven as lightning hitting the earth. And he don't call him Satan anymore. He called him a serpent. And he give us power. He give us power to walk on him. Hallelujah. He give us power to walk on him. He give us power to crawl upon him. He give us power to draw upon the scorpions. The other sick evil things of this family, of this world. And what you did, I tiptoed through the tulips. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm claiming my rights. You have the power over all the power. Over Satan. Satan does not have power over you. You've got power over him. But he will try to tempt you and fool you and make you think you have power. He has power.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Yeah.
And over all, A-L-L, all the powers of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you.
Amen.
That's shouting ground, kids. Amen. That's shouting ground, kids. That's shouting ground. And you have the resistance and the power of God to say, devil, take a hike.
Amen.
Get out of my life. Get out of my family. Get out of my finances. Get out of my health. I take authority in the name of Jesus Christ. I walk on you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. It's time that we begin to let us do some walking. And not so much talking. A lot of us Christians do a lot of talking, but very little walking. We talk a good fight. But we walk a terrible life.
Yeah.
Oh, we talk in good faith. We talk about Almighty God, how good he is. But when the devil comes, we get run back in a corner like little kids. And the devil think I got your buffalo. Huh? You have the key. You have the authority. You have the power. That's what the Word of God said. This is not what pastor's saying to you. Not just over Satan the serpent, not just over the scorpion, the evil spirits of the world today, but over all of the power of the enemy. Anything that is your enemy, you have power over it. And it's not going to be able to hurt you. Pretty simple message. I want you to notice. First of all, we see you have to submit. Bible said, search the Lord with all your heart. Then you will find him. Then you have to realize that Jesus pointed out, my father, your father, kicked him out of heaven. He hit the ground like lightning. And he no more satanic, he become a serpent. And where did that serpent appear at? In the book of the Genesis in the garden. That's when he stuck his head in. First time. After he was cast out heaven. After he cast out heaven. First time we see the serpent mentioned as Satan's power is in the garden with Adam and Eve tempting them to sell out. And to do what God tells them not to do. God told them, don't eat the fruit of that tree. You can have everything else, but don't eat that. And Satan comes, we don't understand right now. It's not going to hurt you. Take a bite of the apple pie. I tasted some apple pie before it hurt. The devil's going to get you to tempt to try to give up your experience with God. Do you realize that many people every day are backsliding because the devil is offering them the things of the world? Christian people that have been serving God a long time, pastors, are backsliding and giving up and selling out to the world. Giving up on what God gave them. And I question is to them, why would you sell out for a temporary blessing when you can have eternal glory? What would you do if you fell out and you took this whole world and you lived to be 100 and you die, you've lost it all for just a few minutes of pleasure. When you could have eternal glory. Because I don't tell you, statistics says 1 out of every 1 is going to die. You're not exempt. I've been preaching one time about the devil, and this front lady in front row here, she said, I said, you're not afraid of the devil? She said, no, I'm married to his brother. Hello. Back at you. Listen to what I'm saying to you, church. We are the one. It's not God, Jesus Christ, and God did everything. It's already in place. All we have to do is accept it, receive it, claim it, and glorify God for it. That's it. That's all you have to do. That's all you have to do. All you have to do is believe you have already received and glorified God for it. God said when you have prayed, then you praise him for what he's already done and going to do in your life. Glory to God. First Peter 5:8. Be sober. Be vigilant. Because your adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour. Well, I'm going to tell you something. If you're drunk, you don't know who it is. Be sober. Be vigilant. Be smart. Be of a sound mind. Know what the devil is capable of, for you can head him off at the pass. We get so wrapped up that he sneaks up on us. Hello? And he goes around like a roaring lion. Now, he's not the lion. Because Jesus is the lion of the tribe of Judah. But he's copying Jesus. He's taking on a form of God. He's like, he didn't say he was, he's like a roaring lion. But God, when he took him out of heaven, knocked all his teeth out. All he can do is lick you to death. Because we already read where God took his power away from him and give us power over him. We already come to that place. He's already took his teeth out. A lion power is in his teeth. God knocked him out. He pretended he's something he's not. He has no power over you. Let me tell you something, child of God. He can only do what God will allow him to do. And then God said, stop. And whatsoever he does to you, God will replace it with blood. If he takes something away, God will give it back to you and more. What is in the book of Job? The devil will walk us through the earth like a roaring lion. And God said, what are you doing, devil? Well, I'm just looking for somebody to pester, to torment. He said, have you tried my servant Job? Satan, don't toy with me. Don't you tease me now, God. I know you've got a hedge around him. I can't touch him. Do you realize today God got a hedge around you? Do you realize you've been hedged in? Do you realize you're not a hedgehog, but you've been hedged in? Do you realize that God has got a wall of protection around you? Do you realize you don't wonder I'm protected? Because there's a wall, there's a hedge called the bloodline of Jesus Christ and the Spirit of Almighty God that can hedge you into his fold. In his image. Second thing he did was took his finances. Took his cattle, took his herds, his camels, everything, his kids, and all his finances, everything was gone. Then he stripped Job with sickness. And Job set up early in his front yard, built him a little fire that burned down with nothing but ashes. He took a piece of that bark with ashes and began to scratch a big old wall that came up on his own. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. His friends come by and said, Job, you must have really sinned to get this happen to you. It's amazing today in this world that people think when you get sick or you have financial problem, you sin in your life.
Yeah, that's right.
Thank you, baby girl. This, give a hand to my first lady. She is my beloved wife and whom I'm well pleased for 46 years. It's amazing how we got televangelists that preach. If you have a problem, finances or health or your family, you got sin in your life.
Yep.
But that's not the word of God.
No, it's not.
When Jesus came to the blind man, the disciple asked him, Lord, who sinned? Him or his parents? Jesus said, neither one of them have sinned. But this was done that God in heaven can be glorified through it. Hallelujah. You don't go through something unless God wants you to be glorified to him.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. When you go through things, it's not because you sin. It's not because your mama sin. It's not because your daddy sin. It's because Jesus Christ wants to heal you. That God and the Father can be glorified through the problem. And then wife come out. Sister, just a little bit close. Close on that. The wife went out. Job, yeah. All right, well, curse God, die. You must have sinned. He said, you talk like a foolish woman. If I die, I'm going to see God. If the skin worms come and eat this flesh, and a bird come eat that skin worm, and a big old coyote eat that bird, and a bear eat that coyote. Hallelujah. He said, I know I'm going to see the Lord in my flesh. Hallelujah. I need to tell you, you may be buried, but you're not dead. You may be down, but you're not out. You may think you're down, you may think you're dead, but you're not. You are living, you are alive in Jesus Christ, Almighty God. That worm is going to have to give up the flesh. That coyote is going to have to give up the bird.
Amen.
That bear is going to have to give up the coyote.
Amen.
You know what he said? I'm just waiting on my change to come. Waiting on my change. You may be going through something right now. You're just waiting on your change. Hallelujah. Just like going to McDonald's, just wait on your change, huh? I'm just waiting on the change to come. And we're going to be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye.
Amen. Yes.
Nine. See, man. Whom resist steadfast in faith, knowing that the same affection are accomplished in your brother that are in the world. But the God of grace, Lord 10, and the God of grace who called us unto eternal glory by Jesus, or Christ Jesus, after that you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish and strengthen and settle you. Isn't that wonderful? Eternal glory of God, after you suffer for a little while, it's going to bring perfection in your life. When you go through the trials and trouble, it's going to bring perfection in your life. And he's going to establish you, put you on a foundation. Then he's going to strengthen you in your weakness and become strong in him. Then you're going to settle you down. Brother Paul, good to see you. I love you, buddy. He's going to settle you because there's so many people unsettled in this world today. They're not established. They're not settled. They're in and out, up and down, elevator, escalator Christians. God don't want that. He wants you to be firm,
yes,
settled in him, unmovable by any wind of doctrine.
Amen.
Psalm 121:7 said, "The Lord shall come, shall preserve ye from evil and shall preserve thy soul." He's going to preserve you. That preserving word to keep you. All through all these problems, God's going to preserve you. He's going to keep you. He's not going to let you go. He's not going to let go of you. He's going to keep you because he's getting ready to come back. I'm going to go to Psalm 24, and then we get ready to close. Who may ascend into the hills of the Lord? Who may stand in the holy place? He who has clean hand and a pure heart. Pretty tough stuff. If you're going to stand up in the holy heavens of God, and you're going to stand in the holiness of God in the holy place, you're going to have a clean hand and pure heart.
Yes.
You can't be defiled. You can't think you know it all. We got so many people, they think they know it all. Nobody can teach them anything else. Well, I want to tell you, I've been in it a long time, and I still learn. As long as I live, I'll still learn. When you ever think you don't need to learn anymore, and you think you've got the bull by the tail, you better watch out because the horns are close by. You still with me? I got to skip down because I got to quit. Verse 7 says, "Lift up your hands, O gates, O ye gates. Be lifted up, the ancient doors, the King of glory may come in." God's getting ready to come back.
Yes,
and they go on down and say, "Who is the King of glory? It's the Lord. High and long on lifted up. He is the King of glory." Can I tell you something? The King is coming. 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 Open the doors. He's coming. Hallelujah. He's the King of glory. He's coming back after those who are looking for him. There was a young man. that I read an article about. We're getting ready to do communion, so hang tough with me. I'm going to tell the story about John being hooked up. All through grade school, middle school, high school, he wanted to play basketball. They told him, you no good. You can't do it. They kept him on the bench. Even in college. You're the worst player we ever had in all of us. You need to find another occupation. You'll never be a basketball player. You'll never amount to nothing. In college, they start the same way. One day somebody got sick, and he filled in. And he became Michael Jordan. MJ. Air Mike. Air Jordan. He became one of the best basketball players of all time. See, the devil will tell you, you're no good. You'll never make it. You might want to sweat, get it over with. How many times that devil tell you to quit?
Oh, yeah.
How many times that devil told you nobody loved you? How many times that devil told you you might well give up on that church? You might well give up on them people because nobody loves you, nobody likes you? How many times has the devil tried to get you to give up and surrender everything? Same thing happened with another little boy, 17 years old. His brother didn't like him, talked about him, running down, criticizing. How many times did your family or anybody run you down, criticize you? Sold him into slavery. His name was Joseph. Sold him into slavery. See, I want to tell you something. God don't call people, you or anybody else in this building, without having a bigger plan than you.
That's
right.
You're just the key to something greater. And if you give up, it's not only going to hurt you, it's going to affect your family and everybody else. See, they didn't realize that Joseph was the key. That when everything got hard, he was going to be their provider and keep food on their table. They didn't realize the whole picture. I used like Paul Harvey because he told the other side of the story. And this is the rest of the story. I didn't tell about it. I didn't know that they were going to go into famine. They didn't know they were going to have a savior. And God told Joseph to do it. He could have sat in that prison cell when Potiphar's wife came after him and tempted him to do things he shouldn't do with her. And I want to tell you something, ladies and girls. There's going to be a lot of time that boys will try to tempt you to do things you don't need to do.
Right.
Amen. And another time, boys, you don't tempt a girl. And it'll be reversed and everything. Joseph let the coat and run for his life. Because he knew he had a higher call. You've got to realize you are more valuable than just 5 minutes or a one night stand.
Yeah.
In some cases, only 2 minutes.
Yeah.
I'm talking about that.
Yeah,
I'm getting way down here. You're more valuable than a one night stand. You're more valuable than a 1 5-minute fling. Your mind is the temple of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
And you say, oh, I didn't hurt nobody except myself. Yes, you will. You'll hurt your family. And everybody else will pay over it.
Yeah.
They come that close of cutting off and starving to death. And Israel being totally lost. He He was sitting in that prison cell for something he didn't do. And there are a lot of people today are sitting in the jail cell and arrested for things they didn't do that they was accused of. Mm-hmm. He's going to sit in that cell. Said, nobody loved me. My kid, my family don't love me. Nobody loved me. I'm just going to forget about it. I'm just rot in the cell. But there was something inside of me called the Spirit of Almighty God. It said, Joseph, get up. I'm not done with you yet. You're going to finish the task. You're going to finish the job. Because lives depend on it. And we know the story. You can find it in the book of Genesis. Great story. John, Jill, come on. I would say to you this morning, the devil tempts you to give up and quit. Resist him. Give him the hand. Don't talk to the hand, devil. I'm going to step on you if you talk to me.
Amen.
I'm in this place today. Well, raise your hand, because the devil have tried to get you to give up a lot of times.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
He's come whispering to you, give up. Go ahead and do it. Go have it. You're fine. Go out and do whatever you want to do. It's okay. No, it's not okay. Because you represent more than just yourself. I represent more than just the renewed ministry. I represent the family of God. At your place, I'm going to ask you to do something with me. Before we take the order of the service to the communion, I'm going to ask you right here, if you don't know God, or you give up on God, or you quit, because of people, things, or situation, you can come back to God. You can say, God, help me do it. Help me to try. God won't let you undo it, but you can back up to the cross and you can take over from there. If you're here this morning, the enemy tried to rob you and destroy your life. Would you come and stand with us at these altars this morning? So you feel when you play something? I ain't gonna beg you. I'm not gonna plead with you. I just don't ask you. Do you want back what the devil stole from you? Because if you read the last of the story of Job, he got back and more than what he had to begin with. God will reimburse you for your losses. He's the insurance company that reimburses you for your losses. Would you come? I'm going to ask you. Or you can sit there and do without and lose out and just take things as it go and hope for the best. I didn't preach this message because I didn't pick it out. It's what God gives me. This is what God told me to preach to you, because some of you are going to be tempted to do things you shouldn't do. Some of you don't need to talk in that world. You know what? I have this concept. I don't want to get old. I'm fighting age like mad. I turned 66. And I don't like getting old. There's nobody like getting old. But I endure what is. I don't try to be young. I don't try to prove myself. I'm not. I'm old. I have a hard time getting up. I wake up with snap, crack, and pop. And I don't mean the cereal. But I know there's a God who one day said, I'm going to have a new time. And a new beginning. The former thing we all passed away. Would you stand with me and pray?
Yes.
Do we want to change order? Yes, would you come over here, son? Can I get some of the ladies help me here? Some of the men help me here with pray. Lord, we just come before you, Lord, right now. Oh, God, we are believing you, God, right now, in the name of Jesus, for these two ladies. And God, for chance, right now, God. God, we know, God, you can restore what the enemy took from us. God, you can give them that strength. You can, and they come unto you, God, with open hearts and open lives. God, you would just touch them right now. God, come into their life afresh. Let the Spirit of Almighty God come upon them. God, I pray, come in them. And out of their bellies shall flow rivers of living water. I pray, dear God, for the power of Almighty God. I pray for the floodgates of heaven to open up right now, dear God, in their lives. God, I pray, dear God, to restore their health, restore their strength. God, to restore what the enemy has took from them. And God, we are believing you for right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, by the Holy Ghost, let it be done, God. My God, my God, my God, I feel the power of Almighty God transforming right now. Oh God, we are believing you right now in the name of Jesus. Let it be done. Let it be done. Let it be done right now, God, I pray. God, we thank you for it right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Can we give the Lord a praise? Hallelujah. You all say, I accept it. There he is. It's done. Just walk on the devil a little bit while you're up there. Hallelujah. Woo! Glory.